Professor Kirchner, Mr. Curtius, Dr. Androne, and distinguished speakers in the head table, ladies and gentlemen. It's a distinct pleasure and privilege for me to be present here today to make this presentation before such a distinguished audience. Firstly, let me thank the organizers of this event for inviting the Institute, the International Maritime Law Institute. The invitation, original invitation, was from my director, Professor Attard, David Attard, judge of ITLAWS. Unfortunately, he could not be here today. He has so many other pressing engagements which prevented him from being here. And he wishes to convey his warm regards to all of you and his regrets for not being here, and also for the best wishes for the successful completion of this program. As you may know by now, I am representing the IMO, International Maritime Law Institute. The IMO is a specialized agency of the United Nations and is involved in the specialized agency involved in maritime affairs, international maritime affairs. So, just a minute or so about IMLI, if I may. The International Maritime Organization, the International Maritime Law Institute, was established by the IMO in 1988. And our signature program is the Master in Laws, is an LLM in International Maritime Law. Over the past 26 years now, over 600 lawyers have graduated from our institute from over 135 countries and territories from all over the world. I'm happy to say that a student of mine, Lydia Ingugi from Kenya, is here today, and she was last year. And also we have a panelist here, Professor Fakhri, who was like me, I won't say many years ago, but a few years ago, lecturer at IMLI. So I have brought some publications of the institute which is out, so please, whoever is interested, can collect it. Right. Now, my presentation will be on offshore activities and the UN, international approaches to maritime security. What I plan to do is to, since we are on offshore and legal aspects, obviously the terminologies, I mean, for lawyers, as you know, definitions are very important, right? Lawyers live by definitions. So definitions, I would like to go through some of the terminologies that are there. Then the maritime security threats. I will go into the maritime security threats, especially the threats that are relevant to offshore activities. Then the legal measures in place. Of course, some of them have already Dr. Blanca Basan has stolen some of my thunder already, but never mind. I'll have to go into the ISPS and the SUA protocol. And certain other threats, he referred to cyber terrorism as well. And also, are the measures in place adequate? So these are things for the audience to ponder, and the way forward. So let me start. Offshore activities, this is what, during my research, this is what I found, that offshore activities is any activity conducted at sea for the exploration and exploitation of marine resources and any matters connected therewith. It's a very broad definition there. This is not a legal definition. This is a definition I found from various sources and put together. Now, the terminologies used for offshore equipment adapted to carry such activities are numerous. The 1982 United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea, which is considered the constitution of the oceans, adopts the terms artificial islands, installations, and structures. However, none of these terms have been defined in the convention itself, as you would know. But going by literary exposition, by what authors have written, they stand to refer to the same thing and can be used interchangeably. An artificial island, installation, or structure means a human-made edifice in the territorial sea, in the EEZ, on the continental shelf, can be even in the archipelagic waters, or in the deep seabed beyond national jurisdiction. These are the so-called maritime zones in international law, recognized by international law, or which is usually employed to exploit marine resources. They may be built for other purposes as well, such as marine scientific research, tide observation, and traffic control, and so on. Our focus is not on that today, right? But I just want to say it's offshore is not only for oil and gas exploration and exploitation. It can be built for other activities as well. So one thing is, I think, clear. You can have either fixed or floating offshore. It can be of two types. These offshore installations can be fixed or floating, also known as mobile. What is a fixed structure? Quickly to go through. Structures attached to the ocean floor, often for the purpose of offshore oil drilling. Most of the working space of such platforms are raised above the surface of the sea by rigid supports made of steel or concrete. Attachment to the ocean floor is by a structural support known as a jacket, right? It's called a jacket, I don't know why, but it's called jacket. Anyway, then floating or mobile installations or structures are designed to float in the water and can be moved from one location to another, as the term connotes. However, when they are at a location, they are usually affixed to the seabed to keep them stable. Now, the 1990, I just went through one or two of international conventions that refer to these terms. You all must have heard of the 1990 OPRC Convention, the Convention on Oil Pollution, Preparedness, Response, and Cooperation, 1990. There is an amendment, there is a protocol to it also in 2000, I believe. In that, offshore unit has been defined to mean any fixed or floating offshore installation or structure engaged in oil or gas exploration, exploitation, or production activities, or loading or unloading oil. So that is the OPRC. The SUA protocol that was referred to by Dr. Branko Basan, protocol for the suppression of unlawful acts against the safety of navigation, the 1988 fixed platforms protocol. A fixed platform has been defined to mean an artificial island, installation, or structure permanently attached to the seabed for the purpose of exploration or exploitation of resources or other economic purposes. So also, we cannot forget the pipelines. Now the focus is not only on the installations and structures. Remember, pipelines serve an important purpose to the pipelines that serve such artificial island installations or structures. When you refer to offshore, I'm sure you have to refer to the whole regime together, right? Artificial islands, installation structures, pipelines included. So that is the first point, the terminologies. As you can see, later on in my presentation, I'll say the SUA fixed platforms only refers to fixed platforms that are permanently attached, which it leaves out the mobile or the floating platforms. Now, maritime security. Most of us are in the maritime security field, right? So you all know there is no internationally agreed definition of maritime security. It has not been defined by IMO, not by the UN. No one has officially defined it. There is no universal definition. The term has different meanings depending on which circumstances it's been used. Now, for example, from a defense perspective, there is one definition. From an industry perspective, from the maritime industry, there would be another definition, which I'm not going to go through in this forum. The IMO has tried to define it by distinguishing it from maritime safety. So we will have to know what maritime safety would be to distinguish it from security. As you know, safety is for providing against the so-called perils of the sea, accidental things. Perils of the sea, such as if related to offshore, would be, say, adverse weather affecting the offshore platform, or fire or explosion on the platform. Or collision. It's not collision, because collision, as you know in legal terms, is when two ships strike each other, it's collision. But if a ship strikes a fixed object, right, it is called contact. So those are basically the maritime safety risks or perils at the sea, which have to be distinguished from maritime security, which are the intentional, willful, intentional, and unlawful acts against safety of maritime navigation. So you call them the threats, the maritime security threats. So safety would be the maritime perils of the sea, security, the so-called maritime security threats. Of course, the aim of both safety and security is one, to safeguard the maritime industry, right? Safeguard whether it's the ship, the crew, the environment, to safeguard the maritime industry. The aim is one and the same. Now, although there is no internationally recognized definition, the maritime security threats have been identified and are well known. The United Nations Secretary General has acknowledged this, that there is no agreed definition of maritime security, and has instead identified what are the so-called maritime security threats. So, in his 2008 report on oceans and law of the sea, these are the threats that were referred to: piracy and armed robbery against ships, terrorism, illicit trafficking in arms and weapons of mass destruction, WMDs, illicit trafficking of narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances, smuggling and trafficking of persons by sea, illegal, unreported, unregulated fishing, IUU fishing, and intentional and unlawful damage to the marine environment. Now, with regard to offshore, what is most relevant would be piracy and armed robbery. We will see what your thoughts are on this, whether piracy and armed robbery also can be considered, and terrorism, right? So I won't be focusing on these, but the first two only. So piracy and armed robbery. Piracy is defined in the UNCLOS. I have to go into piracy because there is this whole issue whether it can be a pirate attack on offshore installation. Let us see. At the end, you all can decide. Piracy, Article 101 of the UNCLOS, defines piracy as any illegal acts of violence or detention, or any act of depredation. Depredation is something like pillaging or plundering, committed for private ends by the crew or passengers of a private ship or private aircraft, and directed on the high seas against another ship or aircraft, or persons aboard such ship or aircraft. So the balance is also important, but since I'll have to move on. So this is the main definition. If I have broken down, to break down the elements, there are five elements. There must be illegal act of violence or detention. It must be for private ends, by crew or passengers of a private ship or aircraft, on the high seas outside the jurisdiction of a state. And the act must be directed against another ship or aircraft, or against persons or property on board such ship and aircraft. So now it's interesting to find whether these fixed platforms or the offshore installations, the floating objects, can be considered as ships. In my view, the international community has not moved in that direction as yet, even for the mobile offshore units, right? If it is considered a ship, wow, it will be wonderful. You can use the piracy provisions to suppress these illegal acts. But we have not moved. I guess conferences like this would be a forum to develop such thoughts. Ship has not been defined, by the way, in the UNCLOS. Ship has not been defined. The UNCLOS refers to merchant ships, ships used for government, non-commercial purposes, and so on, and warships. Warships have been defined in the UNCLOS in Article 29, but not ships. Now, for example, the SOLAS, the Safety of Life at Sea Convention, defines a ship, a passenger ship, as this, a cargo ship as this, but not the UNCLOS. So in the absence of such definition, we cannot say, I mean, in my view, piracy would not be applicable to offshore installations. In this definition, it was there that it must be on the high seas or outside the jurisdiction of any state. UNCLOS Article 58.2, as you may be aware, some of you may be aware, it's a very important provision, says Articles 88 to 115 and other pertinent rules of international law apply to the EEZ insofar as they are not incompatible with that part. So what does that mean? All the high seas provisions can be imported or extended to the EEZ as well. So now you can commit piracy, at least piracy can be committed not only on the high seas, but by extension on the EEZ as well. But again, this would not be applicable to offshore installations, as I said, because that the main element, it cannot be considered as a ship. Now, some people refer to piracy on the territorial sea as well, but in the territorial waters, it's not technically piracy. It may be a similar act to piracy, but it should be called as armed robbery against ships. Right? So the IMO has gone on to define what armed robbery is. Right? Any unlawful act of violence or detention, or any act of depredation or threat thereof, other than an act of piracy. So, other than an act of piracy, which we know what piracy we know is defined. So any other act other than piracy committed on the territorial waters would be, and directed against a ship or against persons or property on board a ship within a state's jurisdiction over such offenses. So that would be armed robbery against ships. Now, this was a 2001 definition, which has now also found its way to a 2009 definition. Now, again, would it be armed robbery against a ship? No, but maybe it can be considered as armed robbery against a platform. Because on your territorial sea, you have absolute sovereignty, absolute jurisdiction to enforce your laws. And if there is a platform on your territorial sea, then obviously you can call it armed robbery against the platform, the fixed platform or the floating platform on your territorial sea. Right, so we won't have that difficulty even though it's not a ship, right? We can call it armed robbery against the platform. So as I told you, I just, if it's piracy, Dr. Blanca Basan said, there is universal jurisdiction, right? So these are the provisions with regard to piracy, articles 100, 105, 106 and 107. I'm having a close look at my time so that I don't run overboard. So basically, maybe these are things that you all can read. Article 100, the general obligations of all states to suppress piracy. 105 is the universal jurisdiction provision that all states have jurisdiction, any state has jurisdiction irrespective of, there need not be any link to the flag state or a person involved. Any state has jurisdiction over piracy on the high seas and by extension in the EEZ. And of course, suppression of piracy should be by warships and so on. So, and also there is another important provision, Article 110, which is the right of visit, which is permitted, right of visit of boarding the ship suspected of piracy, right? Piracy or any other act that is there in the, certain other acts in the convention, we are on piracy. So as I told you, all this would be good if the fixed platform or the floating platform could be considered as a ship. So I'm asking you all the question now, can the provisions of UNCLOS for the suppression of piracy be made applicable to unlawful acts against offshore installations or structures? In my view, the answer is clearly no. Some of you all may have a different view, but my view is no, because international law has not moved in that direction as yet to consider the platform, at least even the floating platform or the mobile platform, as a ship as yet. Maybe in the future, you never know, it may be, and then this will fall into place. These provisions cannot be made applicable to unlawful acts committed against offshore installations or structures. So this is applicable to the two zones, high seas and EEZ. What about the territorial sea? Could unlawful acts against offshore installations or structures committed in the territorial sea be considered armed robbery? I would say yes. It's not armed robbery against a ship, as I told you. It will be, as I told you, on the territorial sea, you have sovereignty to, of course, you cannot hamper innocent passage. As long as you don't interfere with the innocent passage of other ships on the territorial sea, you have the right to protect your territory. And you can do that by commit. Of course, you must have the legislation in place. Coastal state will have to say, if someone commits this act against a fixed platform or a floating platform on the territorial sea, it would be considered as armed robbery. So that is the first issue of piracy and armed robbery. Now, what about maritime terrorism? Let me go into maritime terrorism. Again, the term terrorism is devoid of any internationally recognized definition. This is sometimes good, sometimes not so good. It's good because when there's a definition, you're confined to that definition. It's rigid. But the international community has kept it open so that you can bring as many unlawful acts as possible under this broad term. So, okay, but sometimes having a definition is good so that you don't go too much out of focus. It follows, therefore, that there is no internationally agreed definition to the term terrorist either. However, one thing is certain, that terrorism is committed for a political purpose, as against piracy, which was for a personal or what you call not political purpose, it was more for a personal motive. Now, so there's a clear distinction between terrorism and piracy. Piracy is an act committed for private ends on the high seas outside the territorial waters of a state. Terrorism, on the other hand, is said to be acts committed for politically motivated purpose and can occur on land, sea, and air. So, as you all would know, the focus for maritime terrorism came after the Aquila Lauro incident, where in 1985, October 7, 1985, an Italian cruise ship was hijacked by four terrorists of the Palestinian Liberation Organization within the Egyptian waters. And this led to the international focus shifting to maritime terrorism. Prior to that, they would have considered it as also an act of piracy. But now we have moved forward and it's maritime terrorism. So with regard to, international treaties to combat maritime terrorism would be the 1988 the SUA Convention, the Suppression of Unlawful Acts Against the Safety of Maritime Navigation, 1988. At the same conference, we had the Protocol for the Suppression of Unlawful Acts Against the Safety of Navigation, which is called the SUA Fixed Platforms Protocol. Then the ISPS Code, which came after the 9/11 incident. The SUA Protocol, an amendment to this, protocol to this came by way of a SUA Protocol 2005. And we have a protocol to the 88 fixed platforms, which is also referred to as the Protocol for Suppression of Unlawful Acts Against the Safety of Fixed Platforms 2005. I have highlighted, what I have put in highlight is basically what would be relevant for fixed platforms for offshore activities. So let us quickly go through some of those provisions. So the SUA Fixed Platforms Protocol, as I told you, I mentioned earlier, defines a fixed platform as an artificial island installation or structure permanently attached to the seabed for the purpose of exploration or exploitation of resources. Permanently attached to the seabed. Please bear that in mind. Article 2 defines several offenses that could be committed on such structures or fixed platforms. Any person commits an offense if that person unlawfully and intentionally seizes or exercises control over such fixed platform. Performs an act of violence against a person on board. Right? Gets onto the fixed platform and injures or causes harm to a person on board the fixed platform. Destroys a fixed platform or causes damage by any means, by explosives or anyway causing damage, right? Sorry, actually explosives is the next one. This is causing damage in any form. You don't need an explosive to cause damage. You can cause damage by some other form, right? By some other unlawful act. Places or causes to be placed on a fixed platform, any means whatsoever, device or substance which is likely to destroy it, like an explosive. Injures or kills any person in connection with any of the above acts. So those are the offenses in the SUA, Fixed Platforms Protocol. And what's important is even attempts, aiding, abetting, conspiracy, all those are also considered. Even if the offense is not committed, even aiding or attempting to commit those offenses would be another offense. Please bear this in mind when it comes to, I'll be just going through the Arctic Sunrise case with you all. So when it comes to Arctic Sunrise, this provision would be relevant. Now the provisions of the protocol apply where the offenses enumerated above are committed on board or against fixed platforms. So that's the sine qua non. It should be against fixed platforms. Now the 88 SUA was amended in 2005 and a new article 2bis broadened the range of offenses. Basically some new offenses were brought in, which is now if you can use against a fixed platform or discharging from a fixed platform any explosive, radioactive material, BCN weapon and so on, or discharging from the fixed platform liquefied glass, natural gas and so on, or other hazardous and noxious substance. All these are new offenses. So there's another offense which says whoever unlawfully and intentionally injures or kills any person in connection with those offenses are also liable for punishment. Now, if you take both the protocols together, the provisions of both protocols are only applicable to fixed platforms, I reiterate, only fixed platforms permanently attached to the seabed for the purpose of exploration, exploiting marine resources. The provisions cannot be made applicable to floating or mobile platforms, because the definition is, I told you, when there are definition, you are bound by the definition, which is permanently attached to the seabed. So obviously, floating or mobile installations are not part of that. Now the ISPS code, Dr. Basan, Blanca Basan gave all the introduction of how the ISPS code came about. The ISPS code contains detailed security-related instruments for governments, port authorities, and shipping companies in the mandatory section part A, and a series of guidelines in a recommendatory section part B, or non-mandatory section. Now it's interesting, but when you go to the definition of or at least the scope of application of the ISPS code, section A31 of the code states, the code applies to the following ships engaged in international voyages: passenger ships, including high-speed craft, cargo ships, including high-speed craft of 500 gross tonnage, and mobile offshore drilling units. Now here, the mobile offshore, the SUA refers to fixed platforms. The ISPS brings in the one part of the mobile or the offshore, the floating platforms, the mobile offshore drilling units, and port facilities serving such ships engaged in international voyages. So, of course, the code also permits governments to extend the scope of application to even port facilities which are not used primarily for international voyages. The ISPS code has specifically said governments have the power, if they wish, to expand the scope of application. Now, mobile offshore drilling unit has not been defined in the ISPS per se. For that, you have to go to the definition found in Chapter 11.2 of the SOLAS. The ISPS code came by way of an amendment to the former Chapter 11 of the SOLAS. Chapter 11 was originally security measures to enhance maritime safety. Now we have Chapter 11.1, maritime safety, Chapter 11.2, maritime security. And the ISPS code came about from that amendment. Chapter 11.2 SOLAS, titled Special Measures to Enhance Maritime Security, extends the application to mobile offshore drilling units. It provides that mobile offshore drilling unit means a mechanically propelled mobile offshore drilling units as defined in Regulation 9.1, but not on location. So it clearly, it is a mobile offshore unit which is moving. If it goes on location and then becomes stationary, it is not covered. So that is important. That's what I said, the definitions are very important. Not on location. So as per Chapter 9.1, a mobile offshore drilling unit means a vessel capable of engaging in drilling operations for the exploration, exploitation of resources beneath the seabed, such as liquid gases, hydrocarbons, sulfur or salt. But remember, it should be not on location. So as can be seen, the provisions of the ISPS code are not applicable to all offshore installations and structures, but only to mobile offshore installations, not on location. Again, contracting governments have been given the power to adopt measures to deal with such lacunas. There was this conference resolution 7, originally 2002, when the ISPS was being adopted, which further reiterates that the appropriate measures to be taken to enhance security of ships, port facilities, mobile offshore drilling units on location and fixed platforms and floating platforms not covered by Chapter 11.2. This is again part of the resolution. So just to bear in mind, ISPS had provisions to cover mobile offshore drilling units, but which are not in location. So that is again a problem. Now the threat of cyberterrorism, Dr. Blanca Basan referred to cyberterrorism. The issue is, you know what cyberterrorism is, an act of internet terrorism, right? That is, you use the computers to hack the computer system in a ship, but not merely hack it, to cause some form of a violent act or an unlawful act. Not the hacking that you and I know of, like which happens in our day to sometimes, a virus is sent, and it affects our day-to-day life, basically. This is, it can cripple the maritime commerce. right? So cyber attacks could be carried out through the alteration of information being sent from one computer to another to shut down administrative systems or manipulate the control systems of vessels, directing a vessel to carry out particular orders. Cyber attacks could also contemplate the creation of a ghost vessel. You have a ghost vessel, like you establish a vessel that is you actually not there, a ghost vessel. Or in the alternative, you can, the existence of a vessel, you make it disappear. Just imagine if you're going on at the sea and your communication equipment should show the vessel in front of you. But by a cyber attack, that vessel, the appearance of the vessel is not there. See the calamity that can be caused, right? So cyber terrorism is an issue. With regard to maritime offshore installations, well, maybe it has to be, whether it will affect offshore installations is a matter for question, but it's better to be to take preventive measures than to be rather than being sorry later. Then quickly, a quick note about the Arctic sunrise. I guess talking about the Arctic sunrise, there is no better person to discuss about the Arctic sunrise than Professor Franks, who is here, who actually appeared before the ITLOS in this case. On 18 September 2013, Greenpeace activists on board the Greenpeace ship engaged in a protest against a Russian oil installation, that name is too big for me, located on Russia's continental shelf within the EEZ. This was a protest against Arctic oil exploration. The protesters attempted to scale the oil installation, and the Russian authorities seized the Arctic Sunrise, which was a Dutch vessel, a Dutch registered vessel, and the crew. And the Dutch went to the ITLOS, and the case was on. Of course, subsequently, the vessel was released. The important thing is, now this is also a threat, it can be a threat from these protesters to offshore activities. Of course, my answer to this was, Russia would have had all right to apprehend the, subject to what Professor Franks has to say, Russia would have had the right to do it because, on the basis of attempted unlawful act. Okay, they were climbing or boarding the fixed platform as an attempted unlawful act and dealt with it. Anyway, it didn't go that far. The case on merits is still pending. So now I'm coming to the end of my presentation, the way forward. What are the way forward? More states to become state parties to the SUA Fixed Platform Protocol and the SUA 2005 and the ISPS. ISPS has been universally ratified because it's part of the SOLAS. 162 states, as at this morning, have ratified, which is 98.6 of the global world tonnage, shipping tonnage. The SUA 88, 166 states, and SUA 88 Fixed Platform Protocol, 153. But as Dr. Branko Bazan correctly pointed out, the SUA 2005 has only 35 state parties, and the SUA 2005 fixed platforms only 31 state parties as at today. So which is very unfortunate. So obviously, most state parties to become parties to these conventions. Of course, becoming parties alone is not enough, is inadequate. State parties should fulfill their international obligations by having legislation in place to deal with those issues. Otherwise, it will be merely because, your name will be just as a party to the convention. It's, I'm sorry to use the word, it will be useless or meaningless if there is no regulations in place. To extend the provisions of the SUA Fixed Platform Protocol to floating or mobile installations or structures as well. As you know, at the moment, it is only for fixed platforms permanently attached. So you extend the provisions to cover all types of offshore installations. To extend the provisions of the ISP8 code to fixed platforms located, fixed and floating platforms and offshore mobile units. As I told you all, ISPS is only mobile offshore units, not in location. So all other offshore units to come under the ISPS code, which will be a good thing because actually amending the SOLAS is easier now because of the tacit amendment procedure. You don't need to go through a full conference, so it may be the best way forward in my view. Of course, an ambitious aim would be for the international maritime community to adopt a convention dedicated to maritime security and offshore activities. It's very ambitious, but maybe this seminar conference can be the starting point for to move in that direction. So that is my presentation. Thank you very much. I don't think we can take questions now because I have already gone about 2-3 minutes above my time. Anyway, if there are any questions, by all means. Thank you very much. Okay.